Welcome to First United Methodist Church Richardson, our live stream for week number 2. My name is Josh Fitzpatrick, and I get to lead our modern congregation. We are so pleased and happy that you've decided to log in and watch and worship with us. Wherever you are, whether you're in your pajamas or maybe you put on your Sunday best, we thank you for being with us this morning. I just want to point out that as much of a blessing as technology is, we also know that sometimes it can have glitches. And so if we experience any sort of technical difficulties this morning, I just want to assure you that we are recording this service in its entirety, and you'll be able to find the link on our website, fumcr.com, following the service, where we will have the full service posted. But that said, would you join your hearts with mine as we worship God this morning?
Consuming fire, fall, fall on us. All consuming fire, fall. every heartbreak, through every circumstance. I believe that you are my fortress, you are my portion, you are my hiding place.
Welcome to First Richardson's Modern Worship Service, live stream style. Here at First Richardson, we are all about welcoming people for Christ, growing people in Christ, and serving people with Christ. My name is David Magallanes. I'm the Director of Student Ministries here at First Richardson. And I just want to say we are so glad that you decided to tune in with us this morning. Whether this is your first time live streaming, maybe you regularly attend this service, or maybe even you are watching this service outside of the state of Texas, we are so glad you are streaming this morning. And I just want to say, I hope this worship service is an uplifting and encouraging time for you and for whoever's watching this morning. We'd like for you to register your attendance, and there are two ways for you to do that. One, if you are watching the live stream on our FUMCR page, there's a button just above the stream. Would you click on that and register your attendance? The second way would be through our FUMCR Richardson app, and you can check in and register your attendance through that way as well. We are also continuing our Check-In for Change initiative for March, and we are supporting Go Camp. Go Camp is an experience of summer camp for those who might not have the means to attend normal summer camp, and so we are supporting Go Camp by every check-in on Facebook, we will provide one lunch for a student during a week of camp. Now, this is where you can be creative about this. Normally I talk about we could take selfies in the service, but here you could be even more creative. Take a picture of your live stream setup, your TV, your laptop. Take a selfie with your family. Don't forget about the pets. We love to see the pets as well. So take a picture of that, and then make sure you tag First Methodist Church Richardson on Facebook. You could either do it as Facebook status or just the picture as well, but every check-in on Facebook will provide one lunch for a student during Go Camp. So please do that. At this time, I'd like to invite Cheryl Bishop to do our children's time.
Good morning, everyone. So gather everyone together. Let's have our children's time moment. And here's what I want us to think about today. So during this time, I want us to think about how we see. So look at the story that is in Scripture today that Josh is going to preach on in a little bit, about a time when Jesus healed a blind man. Now, the man had been blind since he was born, and Jesus gave him sight. So in thinking about this story, my friend Missy, who raises puppies for a Seeing Eye Guide Dog program, once shared with me a card about how blindness can appear differently in different people. And so it was a card, and you would look at it and look through so you could see. So we're going to use technology to help you see that today. So there are some people who just see everything completely, all blurred out. And they may not be able to see everything in detail. They might be able to tell if that's a person or a tree. They can see some colors, but they can't see everything very clearly. And then there are some others who their blindness might appear like they can only see through a little hole right in the center, and everything else is either dark or blurred around, and so they are constantly having to redirect their eyes to exactly what they need to look at in order to see. And then there are some people who experience blindness with total darkness, when they are unable to see anything. They may not even be able to experience light. But what I love about this story, when Jesus heals this blind man, is that Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." And during this time, when we aren't all together, what are the ways that we are continuing to help share the light of Christ? What are ways that we are seeing differently now because of who Jesus is? So that might be that you see your family differently because you're together all of the time. Or it might be that you see yourself differently because you have the time to explore hobbies and talents and interests that you may not have had in the past. Or it could be that you want to help others see Jesus more clearly too. So it might be that you could go out on your sidewalk, and instead of just coloring, is that you might write words of hope so that as people walk through the neighborhood, they are able to see that. Or you might go hang a poster in your window for people walking by, or on your back fence, or wherever it is that, like, the workers who are coming to pick up your trash may need that message of hope as well. So find ways that you see differently during this time, and share that with the world around us. So one thing that we have is bedtime blessings. And that was a practice we started at the beginning of Lent, where we have different staff and clergy people read bedtime stories every night and end with a prayer and a family blessing. So on Sundays, we usually send out an email for the rest of the week of what the books will be and who the readers will be. And so we're going to continue to do that, but we're also going to include for you some activities that follow up on the lessons we learned today and on the scripture that is read and the sermon that is preached. And so I would encourage you, if you don't already get that, you can go to fumcr.com/subscribe and find the children's newsletter. Our children's ministry team has done a great job of preparing for this. So let's say a prayer as we normally do, where I say a little bit and you repeat after me. Please join me as we go to God in prayer. Amazing God, thank you for Jesus' miracles. Help us use this time to see ourselves differently and to see those around us differently. We give thanks to you, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, part of an act of worship is to respond in giving. And so as we move into a time where we would normally have the opportunity to do that together, you are still able to do that remotely. So if you're watching live stream, there is a button that you can push that says give online. You can also do that through the church website, fumcr.com/give. Because during this time, even though we are not gathered here together, the ministry and mission of the church continues. So you can continue to support that, and you can also continue to worship in your giving of your tithes and offerings.
that you alone are the God of miracles. We put our faith, we put our trust. And Lord, in this time of doubt, fear, anxiousness that people are feeling, Jesus, we pray that you would give us that strength right now to have the faith that you are bigger, that you are in control. We are giving you our life, God, that in the midst of this, we might be your light. We might be your hands and be your feet to the people that you want to serve and love. We love you. We have faith. And we trust that you are bigger, and that you are powerful, and that all glory is yours. We love you, and it's in your beautiful name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, again, I just want to thank you for being with us this morning. As weird as this is, it's also kind of beginning to feel normal. There's something about seeing the connections online that wouldn't have happened had we not been in the middle of what we're in the middle of now that gives me hope for what God can do in the middle of this. So Megan and I are parents. We have three kids. We have Emily, who just turned 7. We have Juliet, who's about to turn 4. And we have Liam, who is firmly 2 years old. And there's something about parenting that just, it teaches you lessons, whether you want to be taught lessons or not. I mean, we find ourselves learning stuff that we never knew And until you're in the middle of a situation and something's going crazy and you're pretending like you're knowing what you're doing, and all along you're trying to just make it up as you go and just survive whatever it is right in front of you. And I could talk all day about the various lessons that we've learned, but there's one in particular that I want to talk about this morning. That is this lesson. There is no such thing as a ruined art project. There's simply an opportunity to make it better than it was before. Let me explain what I mean. You may have been here before where the art project is completely done. It's due the next day at school, and there's been enough drama in the decisions that have gone into picking the materials or the colors or whatever it is, but finally every small detail is in place and it's ready to be turned in the very next day. And yet the moment that you breathe that sigh of relief and you place that art project on a shelf, one of the younger siblings, it's like a law of physics, inevitably goes into full ninja mode and gets a Sharpie and begins to just draw doodles all over that art project while nobody even notices. And then as somebody does notice, eventually World War III breaks loose and you're panicking and trying to figure out how to correct the situation in front of you, and the older sibling is saying, it's ruined, and you as the parent are saying, no, it's not ruined, it's we can fix this, totally fixable. In fact, that just gave me an idea on how we can make this even better than I think it was before. And the whole time you're in your mind trying to come up with whatever that idea is to salvage the situation in front of you. I don't know if you've been there before, whether it's with a kid's art project or any number of examples, but it's in those moments that we are faced with this decision to either get stuck in our panic or to ask, okay, what now? And act. To either just stop in that situation and start to play the blame game and see why we are in such a frenzy, or to take the next step and say, okay, what can I do about this? Because something has to happen and I need to act now. There's no such thing as a ruined art project, simply an opportunity to make it even better than it may have been before. Now, our text this morning comes from John chapter 9 with a story of Jesus healing a blind man. And you'll see the dynamics of the story paint a similar picture and ask a similar question. This is John chapter 9, starting in verse 1. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." The others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Well, then, how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Well, where is he?" He said, "I do not know." Skip forward down to verse 24. It says, "So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind." This is, let me give some context, after they had kind of grilled him back and forth and even brought his parents into it, and were trying to see, well, who is this Jesus guy? "So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, 'Give glory to God. We know that this man," referring to Jesus, "is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." This is the word of God for the people of God, and we say, thanks be to God. And so here we have this story. It's a fascinating story because all the dynamics involved. We have the man who was blind from birth. We have Jesus. We have his disciples who were there asking him these questions. We have the Pharisees and the Jews. If you were to read the full text between the verses that I read, the ones that grill him and try to figure out exactly what's going on. We have the man's parents who in verses 18 through 24, they get asked, well, how is your son able to see again? And they're afraid to answer because they know if they give any credence to this idea that Jesus is the Messiah, the one who healed him, that they're going to get kicked out of the synagogue and completely lose their social life and any connection to society they have. So they say, well, why don't you ask him yourself? And the whole time people are trying to figure out, well, what is happening here and who's in charge? But the question I want to focus on this morning is that first one, the one that the disciples ask Jesus. They say, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Now, this question goes back to what we call this theory of reciprocity, if you will, from the Deuteronomic Code. From the Old Testament, we see this correlation between somebody's sin and some sort of direct punishment that comes as a result. And as this type of theology develops, Jesus here corrects it. Because if we're able to look at the assumptions of this theology and we follow it out, then we say, okay, so if for every time somebody sins, there is a direct punishment, then that might also imply that when there are blessings in this life, it's because somebody is doing so well or is so faithful. And this is just harmful theology. The reality of life is that there is not some supernatural point system that rewards us for the good things we do or takes points away for the things that we don't do right. As nice as it would be to say, well, if I want a more blessed life, I'm just going to have to act better. Now, that's not to say that there aren't natural consequences, that when we do sin, there are natural consequences that are a form of self-punishment, I guess you could say, and that when we work hard, there are sometimes that work is rewarded with blessing, but again, it's not because of this idea of a supernatural point system. And so Jesus looks at them, and as they ask the question, well, Rabbi, who sinned so that this man was born blind? Jesus says, no, you're asking the wrong question. You shouldn't be asking why, because you're never going to get an answer. Instead, ask what now? And the answer to that is that God might be glorified. We see all throughout the Gospel of John that one of the focuses is that God would be glorified in all things. And Jesus uses this example to say, don't get stuck in the why, but instead ask what now? How can God be glorified? And Jesus goes on to use this as an example to say, I am the light of the world, opening the eyes of all those who have eyes to see. And so the encouragement we receive from this text is to not get stuck in that sense of panic, to not get stuck in the blame game, as you will, to not get stuck in the why, but to instead make that leap toward asking, what now? How can we respond? How can God be glorified? Now, I want to do something this morning that we've never done here while I've been pastor of the modern service, but then again, we've never done a lot of this that we're doing today, and so I'm going to invite Cindy Schaefer forward, and Cindy is the CEO of Network of Community Ministries, which is a nonprofit organization here in Richardson that helps people, assists people in the Richardson Independent School District. And the reason I've asked Cindy to join me this morning is because she has become a pro at not getting stuck in the why, but subsequently asking what now, particularly in the way that Network and your team at Network has responded to various crises here in our community. So I want to start just by thanking you, first of all, for joining me this morning.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
It's our pleasure. The pleasure is mutual. Let's say that. So I want to start with October. Last October, we had a tornado come through Richardson. And in a time when all of us could have just gotten stuck asking the why. Why did this happen to us? Whose fault is this? Is God mad at somebody? Your team obviously didn't get stuck in the panic, but began to step up immediately and ask the what now, to the point where Network became the central organization for supplies and for resources and volunteering. Was that all planned? Did that just come about organically? Tell me about how that came about.
Well, first of all, I will say we did have that why us moment, or why, but we really stepped forward quickly and said, if not us, then who? It was planned, sort of. We partner with the city of Richardson, and we are the emergency response team that is responsible for recovery after natural disasters. But I will say, we had drilled with them, we were FEMA trained, but who really thinks that that's going to happen? You know, you always hope, you prepare. So I will say we were not really prepared for what was to come. We thought that maybe we would be mobilizing some volunteer forces, but we realized very quickly that we were there to help people rebuild lives. And we were not prepared, but I think sometimes in the ignorance of not knowing is whenever the true creativity comes out. And we just, as a team, decided to say, how can we help them? We want to help rebuild their lives. So we got creative, and we made it happen.
And the community of Richardson, I think, is eternally grateful for your team's response. Now, you told me prior to our service this morning that you're from the same hometown as Fred Rogers.
Yes.
Like, not just the city, but
not
like
just,
this small town.
That's right, because everyone says he's from Pittsburgh, but not really. He's from the small town called Latrobe.
Okay.
It's where Arnold Palmer is from there, too.
Oh, so, wow. This is Aunt Cindy Schaefer.
Yeah,
so good,
right?
Things come out,
yeah,
of Latrobe.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've seen this meme over and over in times like this where Fred Rogers tells a story about his mom, encouraging him and saying, when you see scary things on the news, you need to ask, where are the helpers? The helpers will always show up in the scary times. And so my question is, with that tornado that came through and with you organizing the volunteer efforts, where did you see helpers step up in that time?
Honestly, it was our church community and our church partners. You know, that time, we needed money. We needed cash. And I called our pastors that we knew and just was very bold about asking it because we knew we needed help. And I want to say your church was one that responded quickly and generously. And also our volunteers. We have a huge volunteer force. We do what we do with 11 staff, the rest volunteers. And we had people that just quietly showed up every day. And the same people that were there all day and just were that constant force. So, and then other people from the community, HOAs, but people just quietly coming and saying, what can I do? How can I help? And even if it was just someone standing there, actually one member of your congregation who is a chaplain at Methodist Richardson Hospital, she showed up every day and stood by the intake table and just stood there and was that calming presence, prayed with people, and just supported them however she could.
That is so cool. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we find ourselves in the midst of a new crisis with COVID-19.
Yes.
What is Network doing to respond to the needs that are currently?
Well, the first thing I want to say is we know that this could be a pandemic that a lot of us get sick, and Network wants to make sure that no matter what, we're there to still serve people. So the very first thing we did was split our team into two. So we have half of our staff on Team A and the other half on Team B, and we're taking turns being on site and then working from home so that we know that if God forbid something happens to someone, that we have a team that can be on site still helping. So I want to say that first.
Yeah.
So we want to be there. We want to serve the long term. We're still helping with food. And we're still helping with financial assistance, but we're doing that by phone. So utilities, rent assistance, things like that. If people need help, they need to call in, and we have volunteers that are helping with that online. Our food pantry is still open, though, but clients are not coming in. Again, it's via phone. We fill orders. They pull around to the back of the building, and they get their order from the dock. And moving into this next week, we are entering into uncharted territory. We are partnering with Richardson Independent School District and several other organizations to help provide emergency food boxes for the families who are unable to get to network. But they have 14 sites set up to do breakfast and lunch. They're doing sack breakfast and lunch every day. And on Fridays, we're gonna add to those 14 sites boxes of food that families can take home so they can get through the weekend and hopefully beyond that.
Okay, so it's one thing to then look for the helpers. It's another thing to take that extra step to become a helper.
Yes.
So is the system already in place, or do you have needs for other people to step in and help volunteer still?
Well, we have a system in place, but for people to step in and volunteer.
Good.
Most of our volunteers are in the protected age range and aren't comfortable coming in, and I don't want them to come in. Mm-hmm. So that being said, if you're not feeling well, if you're vulnerable, please stay home. But we do still need help. We are trying to keep shifts small, so less than 10 people in one space at one time. We have on our website, which is thenetwork.org, as well as our Facebook page, we have a sign-up genie set up. So you click on the link if you want to sign up, and it has all the opportunities there to sign up so that we can control how many people are coming to our building and when and what they're going to be doing.
Great. So if somebody from our congregation or somebody who is watching, maybe even from out of state, you want to fly in and help with network, we would welcome that as
we
well.
We definitely would. Yes.
I also want to point out that a lot of the needs is the volunteering to use the sign-up genius, but also food. And so here at First Methodist Richardson, we're going to have a food drive on Tuesday. So just in a couple days between 1 o'clock and 3 o'clock, we will get out all the logistics for you and all the needs. I'm sure we have a list that we can supply for that food drive, but block that time out on your calendar, Tuesday between 1 and 3, to join us in supporting the work the network is doing. Cindy, thank you again for being willing to join us this morning.
Thank you for having me. And also, I have to put in the plug, if you can't give food but you still want to help, you can also contribute on our website, thenetwork.org. There's a Donate Now page, and I just appreciate all the help for that. So thank you very much.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks,
Cindy. Appreciate it. I know it's kind of awkward to be standing 6 feet apart from each other, and I wouldn't usually do that in a friendly interview. I kind of just wanted to have her sit across the table, but we're trying to be consistent in the part that we're playing as well and trying to flatten the curve. And now, it's one thing, again, to say that you want to be a helper and to try to make that move from why to what now, but I also want to recognize this morning that sometimes that transition is really, really difficult. In the middle of whatever you're going through, whether it's COVID-19 that's thrown you for a loop, whether it's the economic impact, or maybe it's even on a more general scale, maybe you've had some sort of life dream that has just been completely disrupted by some unforeseen circumstance. I just want to recognize that as easy it is for us to say, well, you just need to move from why to what now, I do want to say that it's okay to stay in the why for a little bit. Because the why is real and the feelings that come with it are real. I believe that God invites us to wrestle with those questions. But this is also where I believe in the power of the Holy Spirit. That the power of the Holy Spirit comes along us and brings us into this next chapter by giving us hope. And it's incredible to see the huge changes that can happen with a small change in perspective. That we go from despair and depression to new hopes and opportunities, but sometimes it takes supernatural power to get us there. And so sometimes we ask, well, how do I pray in a time like this? And my suggestion is to pray that the power of the living God can carry you from the why to the what now. There's this quote from one of my favorite theologians, N.T. Wright. And he says this. He says, "The chaos and misery of this present world is the raw material out of which the loving, wise, and just God is making his new creation." I want to say that again because I love this. The chaos and misery of this present world is the raw material out of which the loving, wise, and just God is making his new creation. In other words, the ruined art project of your life might actually just be an opportunity for God to redeem it into something bigger and better than you could ever imagine. It takes faith and it takes courage. But when we give our worries and our disappointments and the curveballs of life to God and we say, I trust you with this, God is in the business of redemption. God is in the business of moving us into the next chapter and saying, I still have hope for your future. In 2010, Megan and I moved to Texas for the first time. This is our second stint living in this great state. And we moved here because of her medical residency. We moved from California. And when we moved, I had been pastoring a church in a different denomination. We had everything lined up. She was going to start her residency, and I was going to come alongside a pastor who was already here in Dallas who had planted a church and was 1 year into that church plant, and I was going to be the co-pastor of that church plant. And I had never even been to Dallas before. Literally, the first time I had been to Dallas was when we were driving up with the truck and the trailer of all our stuff. And so here we were. We pull up. We move into our apartment. And I find out shortly after, like just within the next couple of days, that the funding for my position had somehow fallen through. And there weren't any other churches in this particular denomination in the area. And I was suddenly at a loss. And I remember how disheartening that was. And I remember asking God, why is this happening? This was not the game plan. We were so excited about this chapter. Everything was a new adventure. And then we show up and the floor just drops out from under us. We needed that income to live, and it wasn't going to be there. And so, yes, I spent some time asking the why, but I also felt compelled to start asking the what now. And I remember being so distraught that I was even ready to kind of throw in the cards and go a different route in life away from church and maybe go back to waiting tables. I had waited tables and had a great experience as a server while I was in seminary. And yet this call on my life kept drawing me back to the church. And so as I was compelled to ask the what now, I started looking online at job boards and sent out some resumes. And it just took a matter of days. I was fortunate enough in this scenario to get connected to a job opening at First United Methodist Church in Duncanville. And I served as the youth pastor at First Methodist Duncanville for the next 4 years. And it was at that church that I discerned my call into ordained ministry as a United Methodist pastor. It was also at that church that people said, well, you got to meet this pastor that we had 10 years ago. His name's Clayton Oliphant. I think you guys would really hit it off. And for those of you who aren't a part of our congregation, Clayton Oliphant happens to be the senior pastor of First Methodist Richardson. And in retrospect, it's incredible to see how God connected the dots over those years, even to the point of me coming to the conclusion that if I hadn't have lost my job as soon as we moved to Dallas, I'm not sure I would be where I am today. I had my moment of asking why. But I also had this opportunity to say, okay, what now? I trust you, God. I trust that you know what you're doing. And I've followed God along the way, and I would not trade that for the life of me. My encouragement to you this morning is to not get stuck in the sense of panic. And if this story tells us anything, it's to not ask the wrong question and look for fault or blame, but to instead ask, what now? In the midst of whatever I'm going through, how can God be glorified? How can this circumstance point to the fact that Jesus is the light of the world? It's my prayer that our church would be a church that is known for asking, what now? How can we step up and be used in this moment? And how can God be glorified through our actions? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you for the ways that it corrects us in our thinking and gives us permission to wrestle, but then also go the next step and give our worries and our disappointments and the curveballs of life over to you to trust in your goodness and your providence. God, we pray that you would open our eyes to your activity in this world, that you would show us the opportunities to take these ruined art projects that we think is the end of us and instead show us where we might have opportunities for new life and new hope, and that all along you might be glorified in whatever it is we are going through. Would your Holy Spirit give us the power to make that transition from why to what now? And may we trust you. God, we pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
So I've tried to remember, as I'm sure many of us have, that with every hardship and struggle comes an opportunity for a new perspective or a new way of life to be born. And, even though laying hold of that, we might not know what that looks like, and I'm sure it's a lot easier said than done, but what a great prayer for us to adopt as we move into this week, that the Lord would do something new within us and certainly through us. And so that's the prayer that this song gives voice to, so join in.
God, I came here with nothing, but all you.
I want to thank you again for joining us this Sunday together in worship. I would invite you again to share your pictures with us so that we can feel a sense of community as we know that we're all gathered together. It's nice to be able to see that and visualize it. I also want to encourage you to find creative ways to make connection, even if it's digitally, with those who you know might be lonely or you who haven't talked with in a while. Make a phone call or an email or a Zoom call or whatever it takes. Let's continue to foster community even in new creative ways. I also want to remind you, as we mentioned, we're going to have that food drive this Tuesday between 1 and 3 here at the church. Cindy says that the items that you can't find on the shelf are the same items that other people are struggling to find as well. So if you have it in your heart to donate paper products, would you bring those? Diapers and wipes and formula and also all sorts of canned and boxed foods. Bring those to the church here on Tuesday between 1 and 3, and we'll make sure that Cindy and her team at Network gets those so that they can distribute them and use them as a part of their boxes that go to the school district this weekend. As always, for updates on what our church is doing, I would invite you to visit the website, particularly fumcr.com/COVID-19. If you want to subscribe to our newsletter, that's another great way to stay in the know. It's fumcr.com/subscribe. We, again, just want to find ways to stay in connection. You're always welcome to just email me personally as well. My email address is josh@fumcr.com. We want to stay connected in this time. Would you receive this benediction? May the God who created you and knows you better than you know yourself open your eyes to the opportunities to glorify God all around you. And may the Holy Spirit empower us to make that transition between why and what now, so that we might be used by God for God's purposes. Amen. Amen. Have a great week.